29. Free of his peril, River Float arrives at the kingdom. Receiving favor, Eight Rules invades the forest. The poem says, "Vain thoughts cannot be slain by force. Why must you seek after suchness? Refine before Buddha your self-existent mind. Are not illusion and enlightenment the same? Enlightened, you reach instantly the right. Deluded, you sink in 10,000 kalpas. If you can cultivate one thought with truth, sins vast as Ganges sand are wiped out." We were telling you about Eight Rules and Sha Monk, who fought with that monster for over 30 rounds, but a decision could not be reached. Why not, you ask? If it were a matter of matching abilities, you needn't speak of two monks. Even if there were 20 monks, they would still be unable to withstand that monster. It was only because of the fact that the Tang monk was not yet fated to die that his followers could count on the help of certain deities. Eight Rules and Sha Monk, therefore, were assisted in secret in the air by the six gods of light and six gods of darkness, the guardians of five quarters, the four sentinels, and the 18 guardian spirits of monasteries. For the moment, we shall speak no more of the battle between the three of them. We tell you instead about the elder, who was weeping piteously in the cave and thinking about his disciples. As tears fell from his eyes, he said to himself, "Wunem, I don't know in which village you have met a friend of truth and are enjoying being fed. Oh, Wuqing, where have you gone to search for him, and how will you be able to meet him? Will you too realize that I met a demon, that I'm suffering here? When will I see you both again? When will I escape from this great ordeal so that I can reach the Spirit Mountain soon?" As he was giving voice to his grief in this manner, he suddenly saw a woman walk out from inside the cave. Holding on to the spirit-soothing pillar, she said, "Elder, where did you come from? Why are you bound here by him?" When the elder heard this, he turned his teary eyes to steal a glance at her and found that she was about 30 years old. "Lady Bodhisattva," he said, "no need for further questions. I must have been fated to die when I entered your door. If you want to devour me, go ahead. Why bother to question me?" The woman said, "I don't eat people. About 300 miles west of here is my home, a city by the name of the Precious Image Kingdom. I'm the third princess of its king, and my childhood name is Hundred Flowers, Shame. 13 years ago, on the eve of the 15th of the 8th month, I was enjoying the sight of the moon when this monster spirit kidnapped me and brought me here in a violent wind. I was forced to become his wife for all these 13 years, and to bear his children. It was impossible, of course, for me to send any news back to the court, and I couldn't see my parents even though I thought of them frequently. But where did you come from, and how did he catch you?" "This poor monk," said the Tang monk, "is someone sent to acquire scriptures in the Western Heaven. I was taking a walk when I bumped into this place. Now he wants to catch my two disciples also so that we will all be steamed and eaten together." "Elder, please don't worry," said the princess with a smile. "If you are a scripture pilgrim, I can save you, for the Precious Image Kingdom is right on your main path to the west. All I ask of you is to deliver a letter for me to my parents, and I'll ask my husband to let you go." Nodding his head, the Tang monk said, "Lady Bodhisattva, if you can save the life of this poor monk, I shall be glad to serve as your messenger." Quickly running inside, the princess wrote a letter and had it properly sealed. She then went back out to the pillar and untied him before handing him the letter. After he was freed, the Tang monk held the letter in his hands and said, "Lady Bodhisattva, thank you for saving my life. When this poor monk reaches your kingdom, he will certainly deliver the letter to the king. I fear, however, that such a lengthy separation will make it difficult for your parents to recognize anything from you. What shall I do then? They would not accuse me of lying, would they?" "No fear," said the princess. "My parents have no son. All they have are us three sisters. When they see this letter, they will look after you." Tucking the letter deep into his sleeve, Tripitaka thanked the princess again and started to walk out. "You can't go out the front door," said the princess, tugging at him. Those monster spirits, great and small, are all outside waving the banners and beating the drums and gongs to assist the great king, who is at this very moment fighting with your disciples. You'd better leave by the back door. If the great king seizes you, he will at least interrogate you. But if the little fiends catch hold of you, they may slaughter you on the spot without further ado. Let me go instead to the front and speak a word on your behalf. If the great king is willing to let you go, your disciples can take that as a favor and leave with you. When Tripitaka heard these words, he kowtowed to the princess before taking leave of her. After walking out of the back door, he dared not proceed. Instead, he hid himself in some bushes and waited. We tell you now about the princess, who had devised a clever plan. She ran out the front door and pushed her way through the vast throng of monsters. All she could hear was the jangle of weapons, for Eight Rules and Sha Monk were still doing battle in midair with that fiend. The princess shouted, "Lord Yellow Robe!" When the monster king heard the call of the princess, he abandoned Eight Rules and Sha Monk and dropped down from the clouds. Holding his scimitar with one hand, he took the hand of the princess with the other and said, "Mistress, what do you want?" "Husband," said the princess. "I was sleeping just now within the silk curtains, and I saw in my dream a golden armored deity." "That golden armored deity," said the demon. "What does he want at my door?" The princess said, "During my youth when I was living in the palace, I made a secret vow that if I found a good husband, I would ascend the famous mountains, visit the immortal abodes, and feed the monks. Since I married you, ours had been such great happiness that I never had the opportunity to mention this to you. Just now that golden armored deity came to demand that I fulfill my vow. He was shouting at me so vehemently that I woke up with a start. Even though it was all a dream, I made haste to come to tell you about it. Then I saw a monk all tied up on that pillar. I beg you, husband, to be compassionate for my sake and spare that monk. Just regard the matter as if it were my feeding the monks to redeem my vow. Are you willing?"
"Mistress,"
said the fiend, "you're so gullible. I thought it was something important.
All right.
If I wanted to eat humans, I can catch a few anywhere. This one monk, what does he amount to?
I'll let him go."
"Husband," said the princess, "let him go out the back door." The monster said, "What nuisance. Just let him go. Why bother about the back door or front door?" He gripped his steel scimitar and shouted, "You, Chu Eight Rules. Come over here. I'm not afraid of you, but I won't fight with you anymore. For the sake of my wife, I'm going to spare your master. Go quickly to our back door and find him so that you can leave for the west. If you ever trespass our territory again, I will not spare you." When Eight Rules and Sha Monk heard these words, they felt as if they had been released from the gate of hell. Leading the horse and pawing the luggage, they darted like rodents past the current moon cave. When they reached the back door, they cried, "Master!" The elder recognized their voices and answered from the thorny bushes. Sha Monk parted the grass and picked up his master, who mounted the horse hurriedly. So, almost harmed by the vicious blue-faced spirit, he met by luck the zeal of hundred flowers, Shame. The scorpionid has from the golden hook escaped. He wags his head and tail to swim with the waves. Eight Rules led the way in front while Sha Monk brought up the rear. They left the pine forest and proceeded on the main road. Look at the two of them. Still bickering and grumbling, they were trying to put the blame on each other, and Tripitaka had to spend all the time attempting to pacify them. At night they sought a place to rest. When the cock crowed, they looked at the sky. Stage by stage, they soon traveled some 299 miles. When they raised their heads one day, they saw a beautiful city. It was the precious Image Kingdom, a marvelous place indeed. How boundless the clouds! How vast the journey! Though the land is 1,000 miles away, its condition is no less prosperous. Auspicious mist and smoke surround it. bright moon and clear wind befriend it. Green, towering distant mountains spread out like a painted scroll. The flowing stream, surging and bubbling, throws up pieces of white jade. Arable fields, joined by roadways and paths. Worthy of food, dense sprouting rice crops. Hooked by the fishermen, three winding brooks of a few households. Gathered by the woodsmen, one load of pepper wood from two hills. Each corridor and each rampart are made strong as if by metal and liquid. Every house and every home vies with one another in felicity. Nine-tiered towers rise like palace halls. Layered terraces soar like beacons. There are also the great ultimate hall, the bright cover hall, the burn incense hall, the text viewing hall, the policy proclaiming hall, and the talent engaging hall. Every hall lined with jade threshold and gold steps, with civil and military officials. There are also the Great Light Palace, the Bright Sun Palace, the Long-Lasting Pleasure Palace, the Bright Clear Palace, the Memorial Establishing Palace, and the Never-Ending Palace. Each palace, with its chimes, drums, pipes, and vertical flutes, releases its boudoir sorrows and springtime griefs. There are in the forbidden courtyard young, fresh faces like flowers bedewed,